Lots of students think of suicide. Lots of students think of giving up because of the toxic environment created by lecturers and teachers that contributes to psychosocial hazard. Hello, good day, my people. How are you guys? Today we are going to be talking about analyzing negative culture by Africans that leads to psychosocial hazard and deteriorates the health, safety and environmental standard in Africa. Today is going to be an exciting one, and I would like you to follow up till the end of this episode. And I want to thank you very much for all of you that have been viewing our page, the comments, the like. I know most of you shared it. I really, really appreciate you guys, and I'm very, very grateful. So today, you know me already, my name is Adeboye Sodiq, and for those of you that wants to know me well, when you go to our previous video, which I'll be putting the link down below, you will understand that I'm an health and safety practitioner as well, and my main goal is for us to tackle where we are going wrong in the health, safety and environmental of Africa in general. So today we are going to be talking about a negative culture by parents that leads to psychosocial hazard. Toxic environment created by lecturers and teachers that contributes to psychosocial hazard. Objectives and planning to achieve them, you know, to ensure that we eliminate such a thing happening to one another. Let's dig in. Negative culture by parents. You see, for those of you parents that are into transportation sector, when you find school students trying to use the zebra crossing, you just zoom up, boom, and they talk back to you, "Hey, excuse me, can't you see this, a zebra crossing?" Your first question is, "Are you a zebra?" This is where it starts from. Have you, as a parent, ever asked your child, he or she, what do you like doing? Have you ever asked your child? Have you ever noticed the behavior of your child in the past week? Maybe he's improving, or you noticed he's always very, very playful and now he's silent, or he's always silent and now he's just very, very alive. How have you contributed to your child's success? And how many times have you compared your kids to their friends, hoping you are motivating them? You see, most of you parents, you follow the trend of the moment. Trend of the moment, I mean, is when Paris Saint-Germain signed Neymar for 200 million, every parent in Africa wants their child to play football. You've forgotten that every children in Africa has their own special ability and special talent, God-given talent. You know, it's like giving Messi salary, the highest paid in the world, for doing what he loves best. You see, you can see a baby playing with sand 24/7, 24 hours of the day, then you keep paying him salary. How do you feel the baby? He will roll inside the dirt, he will swallow sand, he will drink sand, he will, you know. But you all follow the river of the moment because, my child, though, I only want him to be a doctor. I want him to be a lawyer. I want him to be a policeman. Okay, what about those ones doing the engineering? Are they not humans? People in the military trying as much as possible to defend us by the Air Force, the Army, the Navy. Are they not humans? But all of you, what you want your son or daughter to be is, I want him to be a doctor, I want him to be a lawyer, I want him to be a scientist. At the end of the day, what are they doing? Have you ever take your time and notice the behavior of your child? Maybe your child has been bullied in school. Maybe something very strange happened to him or her that she's trying as much as possible in her whole little understanding to understand what just happened, that she cannot discuss. There are lots of child. You see them playing game. You see them singing. Some are very, very good athletes. But how well do you know your child? You find some of them, your teacher will tell them, this boy was the fastest in the last inter-house sport. He or she should learn more about that thing that he or she likes. But what do? Because you are following the river of the moment, Wizkid just got a BET award. They just signed them at 200 million. Now, you are forcing your child to do what you want. You are forcing your child to become a lawyer. You are forcing your child to become a doctor. You are forcing. Then at the end of the day, you say he does not pass, she does not pass. So tell me, you are ensuring that your child is following your own dream. And at the end of the day, if he does not pass, you start comparing him or her to his friend. Look at you, very, very dull. Look at your friend. I don't even know how she is friends with you. Or I don't even know how he is friends with you. He cleared all his subjects in school. Is it his or her fault? No, it's your fault. You know, people who know me know I love playing football. Immediately you close from school, that's why you find out most of the time student clothes are dirty. They try to go and do what they love before coming home because they know when they are home, finished, they are arrested. So tell me, whose fault is it? This is how psychosocial hazard starts. Then it starts affecting them psychologically. Moving on to the next one is names of people who succeeded at what they are doing best. Have any of you ever heard of Dr. Lou Rotimi Badero? He is the only combined cardiologist and nephrologist in the world. I'm talking of a doctor who can perform heart surgery and kidney surgery at the same time. He's African. Imagine right from when he was a child, because his father loves football, his father channeled him to football. So how is he going to achieve this? You see, children are very, very skilled and they can think outside the box when they do what they love. Look at Divine Odudoro. He's an African Olympic gold medalist. You would know this guy, I'm telling you, from I Never Experienced It. When he was asked how the championship final is going to be, he said, that day, that final will be a deadly day. It's either both of us die on the line because I'm ready to run it to the last because I have a black man blood in me. For him to say such a thing is because he's doing what he loves. He will go to any extent. He will undergo any training just to achieve that aim. Have you heard of Robert Katende from Uganda? 15 years chess player. She taught herself how to play chess and she enjoyed it. To the extent that she started building slow and steady and she became an expert at it. Going to urban areas, schools, competitions and winning. She was not born with a silver spoon like you guys. You sure some guys are with golden spoon. 5-year-old South African chess player. Her name is Kajo Naido. You see, when they say catch them while they are young, these are the things they are talking about. And the ogakwatakwata of them all, 16 years old PhD holder, Esther Okade. You see, while she was very young, her teachers maltreat her because she's very good in mathematics, but other subjects she's very weak. This is where the parents come in. She understands that. Why is my child's behavior changing? You know? What is happening? She's always crying. She does not want to go to school when it's time for school. This is where you parents come in. Some of you parents have never visited the school of your child since you enrolled him on her inside in school. She withdraw her child from there, starts giving her own practice, sent her to another school, gave her trial, sent her for exams, which she passed. And she was very, very young when she got admitted in the university. At the end of the day, at 16 years old, she's a PhD holder, professor in mathematics. I'm sure most of you would have heard of the boy who harnessed the wind, William Kamkwamba from Malawi. He invented a windmill when he was very young, and this was when there was extreme famine in his hometown. Why was he able to accomplish this? Because right from when he was small, he loves collecting scraps, batteries, rotors, unused tires, plastics, and so on and so forth. Keep repairing electronics. When he was young, his parents knew this was what he loved. Fine, they let him go to school. They don't have the money to send him to another institution. But at the end of the day, what happened? He got a scholarship. Then here he is today. He would learn more, he would know how to behave more. The latest, which most of you, I'm sure you would have heard of, is Anthony Mensomuna, 11-year-old Nigerian ballet dancer. He has received multiple scholarships. Is he from rich home? No. How did he start? Because this was what he loved doing. His parents supported him. It started going viral with, you know, even the video was not of high quality. But at the end of the day, what he wants them to know was the talent he has that he wants to share with the world. But he doesn't have enough resources. But with the little he has, now, even from the Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis School at American Ballet Theater in the U.S. And we have some honorable mentions like Anthony Joshua, who is an Olympic gold medalist, Efe Ajagba, who is an Olympic gold medalist. You know J.J. Okocha, you know Kanu Wanko, you know Samuel Eto'o, you know Asisa Oshoala, African woman champion, who plays for Barcelona now. You see, these are the things. These people started while they were young. Efe Ajagba keep beating people up. At the end of the day, when they put him through training, now he's channeling that anger in a good way. Divine Oduduru was second 4 years ago behind Usain Bolt. You can imagine how fast he was. Because this was what he loves doing right from when he was small. If Esther Okade's parents have not noticed that this girl is very good at mathematics, would she be having a PhD at the age of 16 years? Come to think of it, parents. These are the things that cause psychosocial hazard. You know? It affects the psychology. Now, we will be going to the most of all. Lots of students think of suicide. Lots of students think of giving up because of the toxic environment created by lecturers and teachers that contributes to psychosocial hazard. How many times have you entered the lecture room and tell your student, "How many are you guys?" "Okay, 45. Only 10 will pass my course." Yes, I'm talking to you. How many times have you tell your students, you will pass the course? Meaning, you can never pass this course, no matter how hard you try. Do you know how it disturbs the brain? Knowing that no matter how hard you try, you are never going to achieve something. Some students have to carry over. They have to spend extra 1 or 2 years in school. After facing all these strikes, then you still ensure that this person does not pass. You can imagine. You know, you make students feel uncomfortable when you are in the lecture room. You make them feel unappreciated. You make them feel undervalued. You talk anyhow. You know, people who already, they just came out of bullying from, you know, cultists in schools. They try as much as possible to keep themselves clean. But you keep screaming, you keep shouting, you know. And at the end of the day, the way you present your teaching is so bad that even students don't understand what you say. You keep setting people up for failure. Yes, I'm talking to you. Madam Lecturer, Mr. Lecturer, school management, you've mismanaged all the school resources, all in the name of you are smart. Money you are supposed to use to buy materials for school projects, you put it in fixed deposit accounts, so that after 3 months, you get gain for free, then return the money back to school. Within that 3 months, students, do you know how many students' success you already buried? That students have to go and take extra jobs. Some people do 3-4 jobs during the weekend just to ensure that they can make it to class. Because the things you are supposed to provide for them, they need it very, very urgent, and they have to provide it by themselves. How many times, Oga Madam? Yes, I'm talking to you. Yeah, both of you. Have you brought out your students and disgraced them in front of the whole class? You see this one? She can never pass in this school. Why? Because you told her to date him. She said she does not want. You see this one? He can never pass this course. He's so dumb. He's always late. Why? Because you tell him to pay so-so amount for you to pass him or her, and they rejected, they declined, they said they don't have. You see? Negative culture. When we talk of negative culture, most of you teachers, you don't want to take responsibility. Yes, I'm talking to you. Hello. You, yes. Because, you know, for you to change a toxic environment, you yourself, you have to change yourself. Your own self, you have to conduct your own self, because your conduct will influence the situation. But you already collect bribery from the students. How do you expect them to respect you? You are womanizing, dragging female students with your students. Like, if you don't leave this girl, I'm going to fail you. You belittle federal students because you find them walking long distance to class. Now this one, only first a shaku that this guy should go for Olympic. He can walk for Africa. Instead of you to understand your students, bad communication in observing students. You see, this student is always coming late. Instead of you to find out, why are you always late? You don't know, maybe that guy has to do 3, 4, 5 jobs just to ensure that he meet up with his school fees, meet up with his course material. You don't know. You know, some people come to school with empty tummy. There's nothing in their tummy. If there's an X-ray that can check the tummy, you will see there's nothing. There's just hair. They just drink water and come to school. So tell me, with all this, you still set them up for failure. Tell me, how is it not going to affect them psychologically? Instead of you to provide or look for a way, why is this student always sleeping in class? Before, this boy or this girl used to attend to my class, answer my question, I don't see him. Does any one of you know where this person lives? You go and check up on him or her, but never. All you see is only fault. So tell me, there's no sense of security. Everyone is not safe where you are. Because when they try to talk, you'll be like, my God, are you sure you are in my class? I'm sure you can never pass this course. And now, there's this toxic workplace again that happens in the school. Employees burning out, fatigue, illness, high level of stress. Some people cannot sleep without drinking alcohol. Some cannot sleep without sleeping tablets. Why? They are owing their house rent. They have to pay their children's school fees. At the end of the day, you are the one managing the salary of teachers, the salary of the housekeepers, and you put it in a fixed deposit account. Salary they are supposed to receive this month. you put it in fixed deposit for 2 months. So you will get gain without doing any job. Yeah, I'm talking to you. This is what you do. You better change your ways. You know, some people are having this illness that they cannot even share with anybody because the money for the cure is so expensive, or they have to go for a therapy session. You know how expensive these things can be. And you are owing them 6 months salary, 3 months, 5 months, 4 months salary. Are they not humans? At least fear God, my brother. Why are you like this? And if I check your record, I'm very sure when you were still a student, you get free ticket for food. You get free transportation ticket. Why don't you make life easy for people now? Everything, you are just so bitter and so stingy. You are so greedy that you only want to make it. You don't want others to make it. This is affecting people psychologically. You find one teacher and say, well, I can't work today, I beg. I'm not feeling fine. How will they feel fine when they don't have salary? Days when you were students, your own lecturers can get loan from the school to buy cars that will take them from school home. You see? But now you are the vice chancellor, or you are the president of the school. All the money, you mismanage them, you embezzle them. When the teachers are affected psychologically, now you say ASUU have strike. Why would ASUU strike? Most African countries, teachers go on strike. I've never, you know, this is really, really bad, you know. Then when we're still very young in our technical college, you can still see teachers coming from all over the world, coming from UK, US, Ghana, Cameroon, coming from South Africa, coming to teach in African countries. So what's happening now? Where are these people? Because you feel the money, the salary they will request for is very high, and you want to gain from other people's sweat. So you just manage. You don't want to give the upcoming students or the future of African countries the best education they could get, but you can send your own children abroad to those teachers that are supposed to come to Africa to teach. So when they become the best, they come back to the country, nobody can be match for them because they went to Harvard, they went to Oxford. Instead of you, with the money, you bring people into African countries to come and train them well. You see? All these things you have to change. And the effect this takes on lots of people, you know, the psychological abuse. Some leads to brain damage, some even leads to death. These are physical consequences. And psychological consequences, that one is really, really bad. Low self-esteem. Because when you bring your students to the front and tell them how they cannot pass, they are the lowest in the class. Instead of you know, as you guys do, meet me in my office, student 10101. I said, meet me in my office. At least that's still better. You remove the shame. Now their classmates start laughing at them. Then it becomes a cognitive effect because the abuse is too much. Now they cannot concentrate in class. They start having learning disorders. Then it leads to severe organic brain syndrome. When I say severe organic brain syndrome, I mean mental impairment as a result of intoxication, drug overdose. You see people, they smoke. Some guys are high already before coming to class. Why? Ask them. Check all African universities. Some will ensure that they've smoked. Their eyes are like charcoal, are red as charcoal before coming to the class. Because they know you are still going to talk bad about them. Some have to take enough alcohol. They will be smelling like H2SO4 before coming to the class. You see? Why some don't have food to eat? Anything they see, they just try to manage. They start having infection, pain. They go home very, very depressed because they don't even have food to eat. You already disgrace them in front of the class. Everyone starts laughing at them. They've been bullied by the cultist in school. Then you hear, how is he not going to Yahweh? That guy now, he has a mental problem. These are things that lead to psychosocial. These are the psychosocial hazards that students face. Parents own little, let's say 20 to 30%. But you lecturers, teachers, you are the organ pata pata of them all. You see, how is someone not going to go mental when he wake up in the morning, he does not even know what to eat? There is no uncle anywhere to give him money for transport. So he still managed to get to school. He trekked more than maybe 5 kilometers from the school main gate to class, or 2 or 3 kilometers. On getting to class, you are telling him he's late, he should face this way. He still face. The assignment I gave to you, did you do it? Yes. Let me see. You see, he's wrong in something. Instead of you to tell him, okay, meet me in my office, understand what is happening. Then he say, see this one. I asked him what is a fish. He told me barbecue. He told me roasted fish. He told me this. He told me that. I tell you guys already, only 10 people will pass my course. Carryover will be like wedding cake. It will be as tall as this. This is what you tell students. How are they not going to be depressed? How are they not going to go into mental state? If we know how to eradicate this, then we have to create an objective and plan on how to achieve them. The first and foremost, what would be done? When last, madam, I'm talking to the two of you. When last have you take your students for excursion? When last have you take them for competition? When last do you send your students on debates? Parents, when last have you taken your child for trial? Because trial keep happening every time. You know in your area, nobody is as good as your son in playing football. There is complete sports paper. What will it take you that, okay, one weekend, just take your child out to his football stadium? Because believe me, most Africans have never seen a stadium where they play hockey or where they play football or basketball because they are from the rural area. What will it take you, okay, let's charter a bus, we are going to the city, even if it's for only this weekend. Then you take your child there, then you find their coach, please, my son is very good at what he does, blah, blah, just give him a try. Even if they don't pick him, but that experience alone, you cannot imagine how happy that child is going to be. If the mother of Esther Okade, if she didn't withdraw her child from that school and take her to a university and give her a trial of mathematics, how will she know she's as talented as that to be having a PhD at the age of 16? This is what we are talking about. Give your children trial. And lecturers, trust students with project of creativity. This is what these people love doing. That was why they chose this course. You know, most difficulties we have in Africa is electricity. Why do you have electrical departments, electrical and electronics, when at the end of the semester or at the end of their final year, they cannot even produce one, they cannot generate one bulb? So what are you teaching? Tell me. You said, yeah, they are medicine students and they can't even do titration. Ordinary headache, they cannot tell you, okay, aside from the fact that we buy Panadol and paracetamol, if you use this one, this is going to happen. You see lots of mechanical engineering students. I'm telling you, people that are very good when it comes to loci, when it comes to architecture, machine drawings. But what are they doing with their drawing? Carpentry. Tell me, how does carpentry and mechanical, how do they come together? Because they've searched everywhere for job, they did not find. Whereas you, that is in charge of creating job, when you were in school, immediately you anyone is having first class, there will be lines of companies, you know, on the way, waiting for your signature. They want to employ you. Second class, they are ready to employ you. Interview on the spot on your graduation day. They hand you over your car key. Why don't you create that chance for students of these days? So what resources will be required? An hungry man is an angry man, my brother. Like I said in my previous video, I'm hungry and you are telling me to come and write 1 to 20. If I write 1 to 10, my brother, you should be so happy. Because you can't imagine how crazy a man looks when you've not eaten and somebody is telling you to do so. How will you be able to calculate 2 plus 2 if you don't write 22? If you can end starvation, starvation in school, that even the students know that even if I don't find anything to eat throughout the day, I know I will get food, even if it's once in a day, and I will eat to my satisfaction. Where are our farms like those days? Where in a school, you know, school we have yam, school we have cocoyam, we have potato, we have at least something you can eat. But because you guys already, you'd have enjoyed that day, those good days. I've turned everything upside down because of your greediness. Now students come to class hungry. How do you expect him to learn? How do you expect him to pass? You are looking for first class. Is there any first class with empty belly? They are going to the practical hall. How many protective jackets do you have? You've locked all of them away. The money you're supposed to use to buy protective jackets. Don't worry, they cannot wound. I know them. If you see, feel that, okay, the school management is not supporting, those handouts that you sell for 500, 1,000, that some people almost become, some ladies almost become a prostitute just because they want to finish their education. Because at the beginning of the semester, you tell them, my handouts carry 40 marks. If you don't buy it, we'll fail in here. You have failed. Am I going to generate electricity with my hand? Yes. Lots of African countries are blessed with iron ore. Are iron ore going to turn into iron by themselves? Is it not going to go through process? Don't you need a machine to do those things? This is where it starts affecting students, Africans. You've seen how you've affected not only one, not only two. Some people almost committed suicide. If you can cut short, at least in the hierarchy of control, if you cannot eliminate, you have to substitute. Okay, this handout that you want them to buy for 1,000 or 500 or 2,000. Why don't you just, okay, this money for the handout, everybody must participate. This money, we want to use it to buy materials like copper, like metal, like screwdrivers, and this, for this project to be successful. If a school can generate electricity free from the electrical engineer, tell me how the mechanical engineering students are not going to build a vehicle or a bus with a welding department that will run the school for free. Because when you put a free generating electricity inside the bus, all you just need is very, very sound-minded people to convert it from alternating current to the direct current, or from direct current to alternating current. Then boom, you have a free bus in school, you have free electricity. You can switch on the Wi-Fi anytime you like. You see, these are the things, this is how creativity works. But all we do is, these rainbow people are trying, meaning these white guys are trying their best. It's not that they are trying their best. They are looking for people. They employ people who they know, yes, they love doing these things. Look at Nikola Tesla. He loved what he was doing. That is why he can think outside the box. They are not forcing him to do it. Parents, if you are not holding your child back, you see, if you want them to do something that you believe it will take 20, 30 minutes, they will do it under 10 minutes because they love doing it. They know if I do this like this, it's going to turn this way. anything that you give a time frame, I'm sure it will be completed very, very early. And how will the result be evaluated, including indicators for monitoring? You invite third parties from great companies during the final year project for inspection, because before a patent would be, you know, would be approved, any new technology, it has to be safe and will not be harmful to the health of people in the surrounding. But imagine a vehicle of 1980 still running for business in Africa. You cannot even kickstart the engine anymore. You have to push it on the run before the engine starts running. This is how low they've brought the thinking. If there is a third party coming in from, you know, like Siemen, generating electricity for people, like Samsung, Apple, coming to check your IT department, what have they created, which kind of mobile? When you hear from experts, because you have evaluated what they are doing and you are monitoring them, tell me, how will there not be improvements in Africa? How will people be affected psychologically? If there's electricity and there's means of transportation, only those two enough is enough to build the whole of Africa, because we have all the necessary mineral resources. It's just for you to find the right machine to make it from raw material to something the end consumer can use. And actions to achieve the occupational health and safety objective will be integrated into the child program. It becomes an habit. You see, like the United Arab Emirates, every project needs an health and safety officer, minimum. But and when it's a bigger one, you need an health and safety manager, or, you know, health and safety superintendent, and so on and so forth, depending on how big the project is. Because even from the air they breathe in, your car must not be as loud to some amount of decibel. It must not be above 80 decibel. It must not be above maybe 100 decibel. No matter the design, the modification you do to your car, everything you do must be with the health, and it must not affect the health and safety of anybody in any form. Every good idea comes like, you know, scrap, very little, till you put them together. At the end of the day, when you test it, then you start knowing, ah, when I did this, this happened. When I did this, this happened. It will be easier for you to eradicate those risks associated with that project. Then you can do your risk assessment. Then at the end of the day, you can execute it safely. The patent can be verified by the government and approved by the necessary body. Then boom, money starts coming in. And please, I would like us, as from this moment onwards, to try as much as possible to eradicate the risk and hazard associated with psychosocial hazard. Thank you very much for your time, and I hope to see you soon.